Blessed be your name, land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. The sun shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Give and take away. Give and take away. My heart will choose to say, for blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Before you guys sit down, somebody escort Liz out. Please be seated. Well... Huh? Yeah, she did take it. Yeah. Last year, when we were at Lead the Cause in Colorado, it was my birthday, and I didn't want anybody to know. So my wife texted all of the college kids that were there and told them. So I had to wear a sash that said birthday girl all day. Yeah. Awesome is a word for it. Yes, I have another word for it, but we're in church, so I won't say it. Huh? Oh, well, they weren't because they, they missed breakfast for that. It was well worth it. In other news, we have the rummage sale coming up here this weekend. So starting tomorrow, you guys can bring your stuff in. I know that if you're like us, you probably have a whole pile of stuff sitting in your garage just waiting for someplace to drop it off. You can bring it here tomorrow. And then Saturday, starting at 6 a.m., we're going to have the rummage sale. This year, I think that we've talked about this, but this year the youth are not doing it because we had annual conference here. The weekend that they usually do it for youth, and then since they are so busy through the summer, that was really the only time they had to do it. So the Pathfinders. Yeah, you're in the Pathfinders class, aren't you? Yeah, the Pathfinders class, they decided to take it over, and they asked the Aspen Roots College Ministry if they wanted to take part in it and split the proceeds. So that is what is going to be going on. So that is going to be going on here all week. Then, let's see, we are having the all-church float trip on July 25th. The sign-up is right back there on the black table. You can sign up to either take kayaks, canoes, rafts, battleships, whatever you want to take. And submarine, sure. I mean, the water is usually only ankle deep, but if you think you can get a submarine in there, then Chris will take you. But the price for each each type of watercraft is on the sign-up sheet over there. Kayaks, $30. Canoes, $51. Rafts, $118. It's always a really good time. It's the same river that we go to kayak camp on, so most of us that will be there are very familiar with it. And speaking of kayak camp, that we got back from that about a month ago, give or take, and we have a video to show you some of the stuff that we did while we were there. These kids eat like piranhas. We have a lot of fun. And that song was dreamed up by your middle school youth minister. We pay these people for that. So, and what's funny, he couldn't be here this weekend. He was so insistent. He's like, you got to put the video of us singing that song in the camp video. So he wasn't even here to see it. But I'm sure we'll play it again for him. One last thing. I mentioned last week that we have somebody in the church that was going to give a matching grant to pay down some of the debt here at the church. We currently owe just a little over $159,000, which is really a pretty small amount for a church this size. But I told you guys last week, we are to the point that we really need to build a new children's center because we are out of room. In a lot of ways, we have Sunday school classes that have to meet. We have one that meets here. We have some that meet in the sanctuary, and it's noisy and it's crowded. So, once we get the debt paid down some, we would like to get started on that. We had a person, like I said last week, that wanted to do a matching grant to pay down some of that debt, and then we had somebody else that came to Chris this week and offered to pay even more. He said, we had a $9,000 donor. Now, then we had a $35,000 donor that wanted to do a matching grant, and then we had a $45,000 donor that wanted to do a matching grant. So if you would like to do that, I would encourage everybody to pray about that, talk to your spouse if that is applicable, and make a decision whether you want to do that or not. And just so you know, all the way through September, any money that is given to the debt relief is going to get matched up to quite a bit of money to get that taken care of. So, and what was really nice, you know, showing this video, and then we had you, Josh wasn't here with us last week, and several other people, because there was a group that went out to Colorado for a thing called Lead the Cause. You know, I told you guys about that. I think that is the most amazing thing that we do here. We have they're leaving for kids camp tomorrow morning. We do so much stuff with the kids. We just got done with VBS. One of these donors came and told Chris that it's really important to do this because it's for the kids. So, and we do put a lot of money and a lot of focus on kids. And that's the thing that makes me the most proud of this church, because most people, I forget what the percentage is off the top of my head, but an overwhelming majority of people will make a decision for Christ before they turn 18. So we want to make sure that we're doing everything we can to reach as many kids as we can. So, and this will help a lot. So be praying about that and making a decision about that. In our prayer time, we've had a couple of people in the hospital this week. Linda Jones had a heart surgery, and she is still in the CVICU recovering from that. From what I understand, everything went really well. She's just taken a little bit longer to recover than what they expected. Everybody else on the list, well, no, they're not. I was going to say everybody's home. Devin Summers, you might remember his brother Aaron Summers. His twin brother just passed away from cystic fibrosis about a month ago. Devin is in the hospital now. They say it's a pretty routine thing. It's nothing serious, but he is in the hospital right now. Mary Mann had surgery. She was here at church this morning. And Luz Darby, who's here with us tonight, she, you had a heart attack, right? She had a heart attack, and she's here with us tonight. So, and she had a heart cath on Friday, and here she is. So, but yeah, pray for her that she continues to heal and recover from that. And then I asked if it was okay to mention this. This is the last week you guys are going to see Gail for a while. Gail is having shoulder surgery tomorrow. So pray for Gail that it's successful and that all of her needs are met. But the main reason I bring that up is because you guys would be surprised how much Gail does around here. So we might need some help in all four services, because Gail is here in all four services. So keep her in your prayers. And then one last thing, Ken Gradwall, who passed away on July 4th, they are going to be having his memorial service Friday at 11 in the conference room. They're doing it in the conference room because we'll have this whole thing taken up with the rummage sale. But for anybody that knows Ken or knew Ken and you'd like to come to his memorial service, it will be Friday at 11 o'clock right here. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy and all of the evidence that you give us in our lives of your incredible love for us. God, we thank you for the way that you continue to bless this church and all of the things that you do for all of the different missions and ministries that we have here. God, we especially thank you for the people that you have put in place to work with our youth and to guide them spiritually. But God, more than that, I thank you for so many people in this church that are so willing to mentor and take part in raising the kids here. God, we have so many things here that are such a close community of believers that are all working so hard to help each other strengthen their faith and to grow in their knowledge of you. And God, that's so beneficial for so many of us here, and it's starting to really show in the growth that's taking place here. So God, we thank you for the transformed lives that we are continuing to see, even at a greater scale than we have before. And we ask that your Spirit would continue to do the work inside the church here and encouraging us to leave the walls of the church and to go out into the community and do the work that you've given us to build your kingdom and spread your good news. And God, for all the people on this prayer list that we have this evening, for Linda and for Aaron or for Devin, as they're still in the hospital recovering from different things, we ask that you would continue to heal and strengthen them. And for Mary and Luz, as they're at home recovering from things, we ask the same thing for them, that you would continue to meet all of their needs and strengthen them and refresh and renew them. And we do pray for Gail tomorrow, that you would meet all of her needs through her surgery and that her recovery would be very quick and very complete. God, we thank you that you hear our prayers. We thank you that we're not just speaking empty words, but that you want us to bring these things to you and to share all of our joys and concerns with you and to connect with you on a spiritual level. It's amazing to think that the Creator of the universe would want to hear from us, that you desire for us to come into your presence and share our lives with you and for you to share your life with us. So God, we humbly acknowledge who we are in your creation, but we thank you for who you say we are in your creation. And that's why we worship and praise you tonight. So God, we ask that you would use this service, what time we have left here tonight, to connect our spirits to you, and we ask that everything we do here would glorify you in our hearts here tonight, and that it would enable us to go and glorify you to the people in our community for the rest of the week. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand now and join in worship.
I am who you say I am.
was free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house is a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, the rock on which I stand, everything around me shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations.
time we get to come into your presence and worship you, Lord, it is a blessing. Lord, we pray that you give Ty the words tonight. Lord, that speak right to the heart, Lord. Nothing can stop the gospel, and nothing can stop the love of Jesus. And we thank you so much for everyone who's come here tonight. In Jesus' holy name, we pray. Amen.
So usually I start with something, and I try to be funny and lighten the mood. And but I kept having an issue come to my mind and trying to get started on this message tonight by starting out with some stupid, corny joke. Didn't seem right, because this first thing in the scripture that I'm going to use tonight, I don't want to make light of it. So I just want to start off with a question that Jesus posed to a crippled man in John's gospel. In John 5, there is a man, there's a place called the Pool of Bethesda, and there is kind of a superstition or a legend that surrounds this place. And the way it went, every day the waters, it says, would get disturbed. Like there would be some kind of bubbling up in the waters. And the idea was, if you could be the first person into the pool, there was an angel that would come, and he would signal his presence by stirring up the waters. And if you could be the first one in the pool, you would be healed of whatever it is that you're dealing with. Well, there were always a bunch of people that were at this pool and trying to be the first ones in. There was one guy that had been there for several decades, and he had been paralyzed. And in verse 5, it says, one who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition a long time, he asked him, do you want to get well? And this is a strange story. But look at how Jesus handles this interaction. What kind of question is that? Do you want to get well? Well, I don't know. I've got a lot of stuff going on today. Yes, I want to get well, Jesus. Yes, I haven't walked in 38 years. Yes, I want to be healed. What kind of question is that? And I say this is a serious matter, and it shouldn't be joked about, because there are people that misuse and misunderstand interactions with Jesus like this, and it can be something that is very detrimental to people that don't know much about the Bible. They don't know Jesus well. People say if you'd only have more faith, then God would heal you. Whatever it is that you're dealing with, if you just had more faith, then God would heal you. That's the reason that you're still sick, or you're still crippled, or you still have this, that, or the other, because you don't have enough faith. If you just trust God more, he'd go ahead and heal your cancer, or that addiction, or heal your relationship, or fix all those financial hardships. And when people say stuff like that, the words that come out of their mouth say God wants to heal you, but really the meaning that's coming from their hearts is if you would do more to earn God's favor, then he would give it to you. And that's not how God works. There's nothing that we can do to earn his favor, but there are whole groups of people that teach if you will just force yourself to have more faith, if you'll do more and believe more, you just don't believe enough, and that's why God's not going to heal you. And like I said, that's not how God works. In fact, Paul makes very clear in Ephesians 2, he says, it's by grace that you've been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it's a gift from God, not by works so that anyone can boast. We don't deserve anything from God. We can't do anything to change that. We don't deserve anything. He doesn't need us. But for whatever reason, he wants us. So when things do happen, when he does heal people, it's because he's good and he's loving and he's kind. But to tell people that they haven't been healed because they don't believe enough or they haven't done enough, it, besides just being completely contrary to God's nature, it negates so many stories from the Bible. And the first one that comes to my mind is Paul talking about having a thorn in his side that he prayed three times would be removed, and it just stayed there. And he says, you know what? I've decided. I've prayed three times. God didn't remove. And we don't know what it was. We don't know if it was a physical ailment, if it was some kind of temptation he was dealing with. One of my favorite explanations is that there was a guy that was maybe following around Paul's little traveling preaching circus that was just a pain in Paul's neck. And when I was reading that, it made a pretty good case for the fact that it was just some guy that would follow him around from town to town and try to heckle him while he was preaching. I don't think that that is what Paul's thorn in his side was, but I thought, man, that'd be funny if that was all that it was. But it negates things like that. And this story of the cripple at Bethsaida is a great example of that. This guy had no faith. This guy didn't know Jesus. He's sitting at a pool waiting on some stupid superstition to heal him. And Jesus comes and so he's sitting at the pool. And I love the way archaeologists have discovered. They have discovered where the pool of Bethsaida is. And because it has dried up, they know what was causing that disturbance. And so to keep it rated G, there was a Roman aqueduct that was removing wastewater that was probably leaking into that pool of Bethsaida and causing gas and sewage to bubble up into the pool. So you can use your imagination. This horse hockey superstition is created by actual human waste. But this... yeah, well, we can come up with something different than that, but... This is a family show. But this guy that Jesus asked, do you want to be well? He sold Jesus out almost immediately. Jesus healed him. But he healed his body and he immediately started ignoring everything about Jesus. Jesus had instructed him on a couple of different things. One of those things in particular was, don't go and tell everybody who it was that did this. So this guy gets up, and the reason Jesus does that in this occasion is because he heals the guy on the Sabbath, and that's against the Pharisaic law. The Pharisees, you know, they're always trying to catch Jesus in some technicality and get him in trouble somehow, some way, and get rid of him because he's causing trouble for them. Well, he heals this guy on the Sabbath, and they say, what are you doing running around doing all this stuff on the Sabbath? Who healed you? Jesus of Nazareth. Like, sold him out like that. And the reason he did that is because Jesus instructed him to repent and cease sinning, and it made him mad. We don't like to hear that. He wanted his legs to work, yes. But did he want to be well? No, he did not. Jesus very often told people that he healed not to tell anyone that it was him that healed them. And we've kind of gone through that for the last couple of weeks. Why would Jesus do that? Why would he heal somebody of some impossible ailment like blindness or being paralyzed or any of the other things that he healed people of and then instruct them, don't go tell everybody that it was me that did this for you. Tell them that it was God. Why did he do that? Because Jesus came to set the captives free and he came to establish God's kingdom on earth. And bringing people into the kingdom, he's going to grant them eternal life and eternal bodies. We all have ailments. We all have things that we wish worked a little bit better, especially as we get older. We have things that we wish worked a little bit better or worked like they used to work. And in some cases, Jesus healed these people. And when he did that, when Jesus healed people, it was to validate his claims as the Messiah so that people would know, because there were prophets that have said for generations, he's going to come and he's going to do impossible things and he's going to heal people in the name of God, and it's going to be amazing. And this will be a sign because nobody else can do this. You can't do these cheap parlor tricks and heal somebody that's been crippled for 38 years. So this is to show people that he is exactly who he says he is. But he's doing it to validate his claims as the Messiah, not to give us temporary comfort, not to make us feel better for, really in the grand scheme of things, the short time that we're here. At Bethsaida, there were dozens of hurting people. Now, this place was a superstitious place, so everybody that had something wrong with them, if they were in that vicinity, they would go down there because we'll do anything that we can if we have a serious ailment to fix it. So there were dozens of people there, if not more. And Jesus picks this one guy. That's the only guy that he healed there. So Jesus' ministry is not a ministry of coming and healing every ailment that we have. It's proving who he is, even when it's a guy like this guy at the Pool of Bethsaida who's kind of a jerk about it. But Jesus offers healing in his ministry and the ministry of his disciples in kind of a limited fashion. But if you have an ailment and it's not been healed, don't lose heart. Don't lose heart if you have prayed for something to be fixed and it's not. I know that sounds weird, but if you have something, if you have some sort of physical ailment, or you have some sort of addiction, or some temptation that you are just tired of dealing with, or any number of other things, and God hasn't just reached down and removed that, don't lose heart over that, because Jesus offers this in overwhelming abundance. What he says in at the end of 1 Corinthians 15, he says, listen, this is Paul speaking. He says, listen, and I'll tell you a mystery. We'll not all sleep, but we'll all be changed in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will all be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that's written will come true, death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and now the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So we will be healed. That's what that passage says. We will be healed. If you put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, whatever it is that is bringing you down right now, whether it's an emotional issue or a physical issue or a financial, whatever it is, he is going to heal all of those things. And we are going to be given a perfect body when we're done with these earthly tents. That's the hope that we have in the future, that they're going to be put away and we have eternal homes that are ready for us, that are waiting for us. But until then, this is what we have to contend with. Until the day that Jesus comes back and takes us all home, which is something that many of us look forward to, this is what we have to contend with. In John 10, Jesus says, "The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." He gives us life. Even in the midst of all of our struggles, even when we're dealing with some sort of ailment or addiction or whatever it is, he gives us life in the middle of that. He will bring us out of that, even if we still have to deal with some of the side effects of it. He will bring us out of that and give us life in the midst of that, whereas the enemy on the other side just wants to steal, kill, and destroy. And this is how he does it. He steals. Well, I'm going to read to you a passage out of James. First, in James 1:13, James says, "When tempted, no one should say, 'God is tempting me.' For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they're dragged away by their own evil desires and enticed." The thief steals our joy and our peace. He kills our relationships and our health. He destroys the body and the mind. And it's mostly through self-induced harm, and it leads us to eternal destruction. That is a hard thing to sit in church and hear, but most of the problems that we have, we bring on ourselves. Not things like this crippled man at Bethsaida, not things like blindness and things, not these physical ailments necessarily. But our emotional problems, our sin problems, our spiritual problems, absolutely. We bring those on ourselves. A lot of our health problems, we bring on ourselves. And the ultimate goal of our enemy, of this thief that Jesus is talking about, is for us to experience the same fate that awaits him. He's going to spend eternity in hell. He's going to spend eternity in hell, suffering and tormented. And he wants the same thing for you and I. But putting it like that doesn't make it very tempting. You know, saying, would you like to trade some of your temporary fleeting happiness for eternal torment? Not many people that are going to sign up for that. Would you like to have a little bit of temporary peace right now? Would you like to make a little bit more money right now, but trade it for an eternity of being in hell, being separated from God? Well, no, who's going to do that? If you put it that way, that sounds stupid. But would you like to have more financial security right now? It might mean doing some morally questionable things that are kind of in a spiritual gray area. Would you do something like that? And we can do it under the cover of darkness. You can make more money. You can have more of what you want. You can do all the things. You can have all the things that the world promises. And we'll do it under the cover of darkness because you might have to do some questionable things, but it's okay because nobody will know about it. What's sad is some of us settle for a lot smaller payoffs than other people. When I was younger, I traded almost every ounce of happiness in my life just to be the guy that everybody in a one-horse town like Pittsburgh, Kansas wanted to party with. That's not much. That's not worldly riches. That's pretty stupid. And the Bible's pretty full of people who have been taken in by the promises of this thief to enjoy all of the things that the world has to offer. All these things that are going to steal your happiness, steal your joy, steal every part of you that makes you want to keep living, and kill their relationships and destroy their lives. And these people are dealing with the consequences. And Jesus encounters several of them. There's the woman at the well when he comes to her and she's had five husbands. There is Nicodemus, who we talked about last week. He's got all this power and all this wealth, but he doesn't have the spiritual security and comfort that comes from knowing Jesus. There's the woman of ill repute that crashes a dinner party that Jesus is attending, and she's one of my favorites. But there is one in particular that always sticks out to me. Anytime I start thinking or studying about the things that the world offers and the things that so many of us that are sitting here tonight have given into and say, yeah, I need more of that. Yeah, I know Jesus is there waiting. But I need something else in my life. I need more of this or that or the other in my life. When Jesus was making his way to Jerusalem at the end of his life, when he was going to Jerusalem for the last time, when he was going to be crucified, he stopped in a couple of places, and one of the places he stopped was a town called Jericho. And if you are familiar with the Bible, you know this one shows up a lot. Jericho's a very rich city. And Jesus has a pretty big entourage by this time. He's got a lot of people following him around because he's been doing some pretty incredible things. And as he's coming to the city, he encounters a man named Bartimaeus who is outside of the city. And Bartimaeus is blind. All three of the what are called the synoptic gospels tell this story. The first three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all tell some version of this story. Mark is the one that gives us his name. And he's blind. And as Jesus is passing by, even this blind guy that is confined to just sitting in one spot and begging because he can't do anything for money and he can't do anything to interact with people really, he knows about Jesus. And in Luke 18, as he's passing by, it says, he called out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. He even recognizes that Jesus is the Messiah. Son of David, have mercy on me. I've been blind and I can't live like this anymore. And all the people that are with Jesus that are following him around that think that they know better what he should be doing and who he should be interacting with, they go and they tell this Bartimaeus, shut up. He doesn't have time for people like you. You just sit here and be quiet and keep being blind and mind your own business. But that's not who Jesus is. So Jesus wades through the crowd, And I want you to pay attention to how Jesus interacts with Bartimaeus. It says, when he comes to him, he ordered the men to bring Bartimaeus to him. And when he came near him, Jesus said, "What do you want me to do for you? What do you want from me?" He says, "Lord, I want to see." And Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has healed you." But notice how Jesus addresses him. This isn't a far cry from, "Do you want to be well? What do you want me to do for you?" He asked the man at the pool of Bethsaida, "Do you want to be well?" He asked this man, "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus knows. He knows exactly what this guy wants. He knows everything about this guy. He knows that he's blind. He knows what caused the blindness. He knows how long he's been blind. He knows how much he suffered with it. Jesus already knows. He doesn't have to ask a question, but he wants to know what this guy's response is going to be. Yes, he wants to be physically healed, but you get a sense from Bartimaeus' description here and in the other two Gospels that tell his story that more than just a restoration of his sight happened. And I can tell you from experience that when miraculous healing happens in the sight of unbelievers, there is a longing that starts to happen within these unbelievers that have seen this miraculous healing. I have seen people healed that shouldn't have been healed, that modern medicine says, nope, this is it for them. They're not going to make it. And they do, because some faithful person comes and prays with them and prays for them. I've seen it a couple of times, and it's pretty amazing. And I've seen the effect that it has on people that are around, that aren't believers. They think that this is stupid. What are you doing going in there and praying for grandma? She's not going to, they told you she's not going to make it. I mean, this is a story of my own family. When my great-grandma was in the hospital, they said, you can't go in there, you can't make any noise, you can't touch her, because she's passing away. Everybody go in and say your goodbyes. I was in Washington. This is when I lived in D.C., so I didn't get back in time for this, but I have heard the story from my dad and both of my aunts that Chris, being Chris, walks in like he owns a place and says very loudly, "Ruby, I'm going to pray for you." And then he grabbed her hand and prayed for her. And they're all like, "Oh, you can't do that. You can't talk loud. And you can't touch her. You're going to kill her." And by the time he got on the elevator to go downstairs, go back to his car, she was sitting up in bed asking for something to eat. When things like that happen, when unbelievers are there to witness it, it changes them. And it causes them to have this really almost supernatural curiosity. What caused this to happen? Why on earth, if God is real, why would he do this in this situation? And that's what Jesus does for Bartimaeus. And this is the kind of effect that it has, because he continues on to Jericho. And news of Bartimaeus' healing has reached Jericho by the time Jesus gets there. Before he even gets to town, there is a huge crowd of people, and they want to see this traveling sideshow that is Jesus' ministry. Because all they know is he heals people. I've heard that. He says some things that make the politicians mad. We like that because we hate the politicians. Yeah, let's go hear what Jesus has to say. So there's excitement. In the ancient world is no different than today. There was every kind of sin that you could engage in. There was every kind of regret and emptiness and longing for wholeness that we have today. The human condition has not changed. And there was one man in particular that was in desperate need of the wholeness and spiritual wellness that he couldn't find in any kind of carnal indulgence. He couldn't find in any kind of sinful endeavor. He had this longing for wholeness that he couldn't find anywhere else. Tax collectors in the ancient world were scum. They were the worst kind of people. IRS agents are kind of like that today. Take that out of the video. I don't want to get audited. Now, tax collectors in the Roman world, they worked for the Roman overlords. So the Romans would come in and they would occupy a place and they would say, "You guys aren't free people anymore. We're in charge and you're our subjects. And now you're less than human because we don't like you." By the way, we're going to collect taxes, a lot, and you're going to pay them or else. And these people that volunteered to be the tax collectors were usually locals. They were opportunists that sold out their own people to make a little money. So they weren't welcome in the synagogue anymore. When the Romans came into Judea and people signed up to be tax collectors, they weren't welcome anymore. You couldn't go, in our context today, you couldn't go to church, you wouldn't be welcome. We don't want you here. I know that you're a Jew, I know that you're one of us, but you're not one of us. You've told us that you're not one of us anymore, so you're not welcome here anymore. So their own people didn't like them. They ostracized them. The Romans, who they worked for, thought they were less than human, so they didn't want anything to do with them. So all they had was each other. Zacchaeus was the chief tax collector. And in a cutthroat business like tax collecting, I imagine there's not many people that want to hang out with the boss. How many of you guys want to go hang out with your boss on the weekend? That's what I thought. There was also a Pharisaic law that prohibited Jews from intermingling with Gentiles like these Romans. So everywhere that Zacchaeus looked, he was hated by everybody. He was hated by his own people because he sold them out. He was hated by the Romans because they prized strength and ability. And the Jews didn't have that. And their one puny god, as far as the Romans were concerned, was a joke. So Zacchaeus was a rich and feared man. In Luke 19, as Jesus is coming into Jericho, it says, a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector, and he was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he couldn't see over the crowd. So he ran ahead, and he climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. So he was rich, and he was feared. And I imagine that climbing a tree for somebody like him so that you can see over the crowd was probably pretty humiliating. But put yourself in his shoes. Imagine being in his situation. He's probably past the point of caring what anybody thinks about him because nobody likes him. Everywhere he turns, people just kind of tolerate him. This is where he differs from last week. We talked about Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a man of high standing. He was a man of honor. He was a man that when he walked into a room, people stood up. When he spoke, people listened. Zacchaeus is kind of the opposite. He's also a Jew. He's one of the people. He is one of the community. But he's been ostracized because of his decisions. Nobody wants anything to do with him. Nobody likes him. He needs his life changed, but he feels unworthy to come to Jesus. So that's how Zacchaeus and Nicodemus differ. Here's how they're similar. In Luke 19, in verse 5, it says, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. You know, it was a great honor to have some dignitary come and tell you, I'm going to stay at your house and we're going to have a meal at your house. I'm choosing you to host me. This is a big honor for Zacchaeus. This is how things have changed, because if somebody came to my wife's house and said, hey, we're staying at your house and we're having a meal at your house, she would not react very well to that. And I don't think a lot of people would. Who wants unexpected company? I sure don't. But Jesus came and he got both of them. Where both of these guys were, Nicodemus was afraid to come to Jesus because he didn't want to give up what he had. He wanted to stay in the shadows, in the darkness, and to continue to have his version of what God says, this is what your life should be. He wanted to stay in the shadows. Jesus went to him, and he met him in the shadows, and he brought him out. Zacchaeus was afraid because he didn't think he was worthy. Jesus doesn't want me. Nobody else likes me. The Romans hate me. My people, they spit on me. They do horrible things to my house. They vandalize my stuff. They hate me. Jesus is going to be no different. But Jesus met him in the tree that he was in, and he called him down, and he says, Zacchaeus, that God-sized hole that you have in your spirit that you've tried to fill with so many other things can't be filled with anything that the world has to offer, because the only thing that the world has to offer you is going to steal your joy and your peace. It's going to kill your relationships, and it's going to destroy your life. But I'm offering you life, and I'm offering it to you abundantly. If there was ever anyone that wanted to be well, it was Zacchaeus. He didn't want to be healed of some ailment or healed of some addiction or some temptation. He just wanted to be whole. And that's what Jesus offers. He offers wholeness. He says, I don't care what you're struggling with. I don't care what you've done. I don't care that you don't think that you should be anywhere near me. I'm coming to you. Zacchaeus' story ends by Jesus saying to all of the people, today salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. He is one of you. He is one of us. Because the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. How many of you guys have ever felt lost? I sure have. Felt like you're unworthy because of the choices that you've made. Jesus' message to everyone sitting here tonight is the same as his message to Zacchaeus. No matter what your past is or what you're wrapped up in right now, you have been purchased at a cost out of Jesus' unfathomable love. And in Romans 8, Paul explains what it means for us to be purchased at this cost of Jesus' blood. He says, for I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels or demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So if you feel lost, or if you feel unworthy, Jesus is calling you to come down out of your tree because he wants to come and stay with you. Will you please rise for the benediction? If Jesus has called you and you have answered his call and you follow him, and you have been made whole by him, then we have a job to do. And that's our benediction every week. It's the Great Commission. We receive the benediction, Jesus says, to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, sharing with them all that I've given you, and surely I will be with you until the very end of the age. Amen.
Lord, turn his face toward you.